We will be in Psalm 116 tonight. If you have a Bible or device you want to turn to, it will come out of devotional from the Life Recovery devotional book. That devotional will not be in your Life Recovery Bible, but it will be day 7 of your devotional. Serenity prayer. Say it with me, and you may not know the whole thing, but you'll know the first part. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did the sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Step one, so we admitted that we were powerless over our dependencies, right? We can stop there and just put everybody on the spot, because we've got to come to the place that we admit that we were powerless over some of those things, and that we are still powerless over the things that continue to come in front of us as Christians, as believers, and especially people in recovery. I think we face more attacks from the enemy than your normal folk that'll come on a Sunday morning and drive up in the Range Rover and, you know, and just, you know, have a normal, happy life. We are struggling through the process right here. Guess what? We actually made it through 2020.
Yeah.
That's amazing in itself, right? So we made it through tremendous hardship to get us to this new year. And the title of the lesson is The End of Ourself. To get to the end of ourself so that we can find the new me. And who is that inside? Andrea, great setup with testimony that she finally found out and is finding out who she actually is. And as Christians, you know, the identity crisis, first of all, in the recovery community is just tremendous. People don't even know who they are. I'm an alcoholic and I'm an addict. And I wanted to play this one video today, because I was doing some research today and just kind of fine-tuning myself and my spirit for tonight, but I didn't play it because the one guy said in the video, I'll be an alcoholic all my life. And I'm not believing it. I'm sorry, I'm not receiving it. Anybody receiving that in the room?
Yeah.
No, no way.
No,
I'm
okay.
The Word of God has come into our lives to set us free. We're here at a faith-based meeting tonight using the Life Recovery Bible because it's the Word of God. Jesus said, I'm going to come and I'm going to set you free, right? He said, when you're free, you're what? You're free indeed. We don't need to be trapped by the chains of addiction and label ourselves an alcoholic or an addict. We are a child of the Most High God. That's what we have to see. We have to believe that we are not who we used to be. So using the Life Recovery Bible, which has the Serenity Prayers and recovery devotionals and profiles to read on and all the step lessons that you want to do through the whole year, you can do one. Most of all, it's the Word of God. And what we have to learn is that we have to come to the end of ourselves, all the stuff that we have learned prior to Christ, right? All the stuff that we learned B.C., in the world that taught us who were we supposed to be, who we were not, you're not going to be nothing, you'll never do anything in life substantial, you'll never be anybody. And then we meet this God, the creator of all the universe, right? And he says, no, you're my child, you're my son, you're my daughter, and I've got a purpose and a plan for your life, and I'm going to see that it happens. Matter of fact, the Word says that there's going to be an expected end. That he has a future and a hope for everybody in this room. Listen, I'm standing on that.
Yes.
Because I was tired of being told I wasn't going to be nothing.
Yes.
Identity crisis is serious, but we've got to learn to surrender. It's a paradox of powerlessness in step number one. We admitted that we were powerless over our dependencies, whether that be alcohol, drugs, pornography, food addiction, gambling, shopping. The list goes on and on. You all know how many got a lot of pair of shoes?
Yeah.
I'm going to keep my hand because I got a ton of sneakers. It's bad, isn't it, sometimes? Like you see a pair, you think you need another, I don't need another pair of sneakers. Stop it, Bob. That's what I hear in my head. And I love the supermarket. Guess what? I would much rather be in a supermarket than in a mall. Yes? Anybody with me? I love a supermarket. I love shopping for food, man. I do, especially when I got money. Stimulus check, guess where that's going? It's going in my fridge. That's it. But we've got to learn that in order to get to this place where we've come to the end of ourselves, we've got to learn that there's a paradox that we have to complete, which is powerlessness. It's a spiritual action where we find ourselves to in order to gain something, we've got to relinquish everything. See, God doesn't want some of it, He wants all of it. And in order for all these spiritual blessings to happen in our lives, we've got to get to a place where we are not about this world anymore. Because that was ourself. That's what we did before Christ. Here goes a definition of a paradox. A statement or a proposition that sounds senseless, logically unacceptable, or self-contradictory, but when investigated or explained may prove to be well-founded and true, and it's kind of like an oxymoron. It's like a big shrimp that you buy in a supermarket. I'll just keep it there. So step number one, we admitted that we are powerless over these dependencies, right? And that our lives have become unmanageable. So for those that have worked the process of the steps and have been through the 12 steps at a time, maybe in a program, maybe a holistic program, and not a faith-based program, you have worked the process, but step number one, you had to come to realize that life was unmanageable, you were out of control, you had no control, you were powerless over everything that you struggled with, and what you did actually was make a self-examination of yourself. You didn't need a doctor to tell you that you were out of your mind. Right? And what we tried to do was medicate ourselves so that we didn't think we were out of our mind, and then we would just walk around, look like we're stoned the whole time. Totally medicated. God's trying to change us. And He's trying to change us right here in our heart. He's trying to change you from the inside out. But we've got to be willing to surrender to become powerless over this life around us and allow God to do this amazing work inside of us so that we can become all that He desires us to be. Amen?
Amen.
So step one is the first step to freedom. It's to admit to myself that something is seriously wrong with my life. I've created messes in my life. Perhaps our whole life had become a mess. I was thinking today is I had so much going through my head. And I'm thinking there's so many people that have come to me and said, because they know about our group. And yeah, we've got some people that want to say goofy stuff and stuff like that, right, about what we do. Listen, all I got to tell you is we're getting better. Well, there's people in this room that are getting their lives back on track. That's all I know. So when one of those skeptics will come, and I know who they are, I know just by the way that they ask me, so what goes on Friday now? And here's what I tell them, and I kid you not, you know what I tell them? I said, we raise dead people on Friday. And they go, what? We raised dead. I said, absolutely, we raised dead people on Friday nights. I said, you should come out and see those people live. I said, because they had been dead in their sin and transgression, and God will come in and change them from the inside out and raise them up to be somebody. You want to see somebody's life change? Come to Friday nights. We'll raise them right in front of your eyes. Oh, you guys are weird. No, we're alive.
Yes.
We are alive in Christ Jesus. That's what we are. I do the things that I later regret doing, and I tell myself that I will not do them again. There's an obsessive compulsive behavior that we have, especially when we first start the step process, is that we want to revert back to the addiction. And the obsessiveness is the stuff that we think about, the emotion that we go through, and it becomes a desire to use. And then the compulsiveness is when we start to act out and we relapse back into. And here's the problem, is that there's people that have worked the steps, they've gone through the process, and they've done Bible studies, and they've shared testimony. And then they want to do something that's just going to take all that stuff away. Why? Because, what is the acronym RID? Restless, irritable, and discontent. RID is what we struggle with. So we get restless, we get, what's the I? Irritable. Oh, wait. I know a couple irritable people in this room.
Is he looking
and
at
then
the
we
mirror?
Become discontent in our recovery. We become discontent in the program that we're in. And we go, oh, I don't like this anymore. I just want to move and I want to run away and I'm going to get this thing on my own. No, you're not. You're still powerless over your dependency. And then your life's going to become a mess again. And then you're going to go, oh, can I come back? Can you get me back into rehab, because I should have never went where I went. And it's the truth. It's sad, but that's the decisions that we make. Under the destruction of alcoholism or drug addiction, we were driven to places like AA or NA, right? And there they discovered, and we discovered, a lot of people, now listen to Paul's testimony, we went to an intervention. That gentleman, Bob's doing well. He's still in treatment as of New Year's Day. So Paul went with me, and we just had a wonderful conversation with Bob and his wife, and he's there at Brookdale up in the Poconos, and I was listening to Paul's testimony. That's where it started in AA for Paul, and then found out who Christ was. But we found out the nature of our situation in those programs, and that's okay. But God's got a bigger plan to a program. You cannot box him up into a program or a step lesson. It ain't gonna, he's not gonna let it happen. He's not going to let it happen. So step one, day seven of your devotional. If you have the blue book, you can go back and read that. It's the end of yourselves. It comes from Psalm 116. I want to read the scripture, and then I'll read you the lesson, and we'll discuss. Psalm 116. I want you to listen to this. Listen to this. There's five I wills in this psalm that will take dedication and commitment from you. And I want you to listen to the psalmist, what he says, because he's at the end of himself in this psalm. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he has inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I will call upon him as long as I live. The pains of death surrounded me. The pangs of Sheol laid hold of me. I found trouble and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I implore you, deliver my soul. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Yes, our God is merciful. The Lord preserves the simple. I was brought low and he saved me. Return to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from falling. You have to start worshiping. Here goes the next I will. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living.
Yes.
I believe, therefore I spoke. I am greatly afflicted. I said in my haste, all men are liars. Can I just say all men and women are liars? Just men, it says? Anybody was going to say it, it'd be you. What shall I render to the Lord for his benefits towards me? Third, I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. Fourth, I will pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your maidservant. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you the fifth I will. I will offer to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and will call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of his people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. From the lesson, for some of us, we had to stare death in the face before we could admit our need for help. I'll stop there. How many times were we this close? The overdoses, okay, the places where we wound up that we knew we should not have been, and there were weapons involved and bad things going on, and somehow, some way we made it. Isn't it funny how somehow, some way you made it out of that? Do you think there's a reason and a purpose for that? Absolutely. But for some of us, we did have to stare death in the face in order to say, okay, I got to do something. Like for me, it was jail. I would have died. I know I would have died. I was involved in so much in the world. If I didn't go to prison in 1997, I would have died. Not a doubt in my mind. We may experience a crisis where we literally come close to death. We may be overwhelmed by depression or suicidal tendencies and self-destructive behaviors. Sometimes it is our hopelessness, listen to me, sometimes it is our hopelessness and despair that act as a springboard driving us into recovery. When we realize that we are at the end of ourselves, we may find the humility to reach out and accept the help that we need. And we got to get rid of the pride, man. It says here, King David, whom God loved dearly, felt this way too. He once said, the pains of death surround me. The pangs of Sheol laid hold of me. I found trouble and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I implore you, deliver my soul. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits towards me? I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. David had hit bottom. He had finally come to the point of realizing that he had nothing to offer except an empty cup. A life in need of salvation. What did he have left to offer? All he had was a sacrifice of thanksgiving to God for what he has done. When we reached our darkest hour and we feel that all hope is lost, we may be closer to the help we need than ever before. When death stares us in the face and we realize that our cup is empty, we can lift up our empty cup by admitting our powerlessness and thus open up to salvation. In time, we too will be able to be thankful once again. I think as we, you know, walk through the process of recovery, there's a gratefulness in our heart for what God has done in our lives, period. Salvation alone is enough, right? For him to save our soul and give us the hope of heaven in our heart, because if we're saved in this room and you are a born-again Christian, you surrendered your heart to Jesus Christ at one point or another in your life, then there is a place called heaven. But what about for those who did not? What about for those who are still trying to do this on their own? The hope of heaven alone will change you in your heart. The Bible says that God has put eternity into the hearts of men. I'm sorry. That's what it says. It doesn't say women. No, but he has. He has put eternity in the hearts of us so that we can have this hope that one day there is a better life for those that pass on to the other side. But what about those who don't have that? Where do they stand? That's got to be crazy in the world that we live in. To not have any hope and feel hopeless and desperate and powerless without anything to lean on.
I'm going to just start singing. That was almost like one of those Disney songs, wasn't it? Star Trek? Is that what it was?
We got to learn to have confidence, right? As we read through the psalm and we look at the declarations that the psalmist made, because he inclined his ear to me, I will call upon him, right? I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I will make a vow to the Lord in the presence of his people. And I will offer up a sacrifice of thanksgiving. We've got to have some kind of confidence. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4 that we can come boldly to the throne room of grace to receive confidence and help in our time of need. The Bible wants to give us that confidence because it's given us a new identity. A believer in Jesus Christ should not be one that's arrogant and boastful and I've got everything because I got Jesus. No, you've got nothing, but you've got Jesus. And that's part of the problem, is that people get on the high horse like they're coming through the clouds with Jesus to come take everybody home or something. Yeah, I'm right. Yeah, he's on that white horse. Yeah, I'm on right next to him in that pink one. That was for the girls. In Hebrews chapter 10, it says not to throw away your confidence, and we can do that. We can be in despair, and we can feel hopeless at times, and our confidence will relinquish it. We'll wind up giving that over to something else that takes over everything that you've accomplished up until this point. And you have to be very, very careful. I tell you what, I got saved October 1997 in a prison chapel. So I've been a Christian since that day, October 9th, 1997. I have to tell you, honestly, that this first week of this new year of 2021 has been my best year ever. It's been my best week, first week of the year ever, entirely as a Christian. And I'm talking spiritually. Oh yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on. I could tell you 100 things that looks wrong. But guess what? Spiritually, emotionally, and physically, this week has been tremendous.
Amen.
Why? Because I was determined to change some things. I was determined to change some things that are going to benefit me now and benefit me in the future. And it's going to benefit all you.
Yes.
And it's going to benefit everybody around me. And I believe that with all my heart. I don't say that to boast. I don't say that out of pride or arrogance. I say that because I am making a vow to the Lord. I'm making a commitment to change some things in my life that are going to be beneficial. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Be diligent or committed to present yourself to God, one not to be ashamed before him, rightly dividing the word of truth. This is the book that changes you right here. It's not going to be your devotional. It's not going to be the daily bread. It's not the first step, the last step, and no matter how many times you went through the steps. When you come to the end of yourself and you are willing to be powerless under this, this is when things start to really change. They do. Because, you know, I'm visiting my dad, you know, and he likes Joel Osteen, and I'm gonna say it. And I said, Dad, we have to get away from that. And I'm going to tell you why, because this is what he told me. And I like to take him to church when I go visit him, and he does go sometimes, and he loves the Lord. He does. My dad gets saved every Sunday. He says the Lord's Prayer. He makes sure he's saved every time, whatever preacher's on the TV that's saying.
And I said, Dad, I want to ask you a question. I said, why do you watch him? You know what he told me? He makes me feel like I'm going to hit the lottery. And I said, don't you think there's something wrong with that? And he went, yeah, I think there's something wrong with that. And then we'll pray and we'll talk about the Word and talk about God. And I've got to get away from some of this craziness, man.
Amen.
And just get in the book.
Amen.
Just read it. I've got to change you from the inside out. Commit your works to the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him. And He will direct your path. Listen, He doesn't say, I might direct your path. He doesn't say, I might supply all your needs. He doesn't say, some things will work together for good. No, they're definitive, imperative statements that God makes, that He says, all things work together for good.
Amen.
For those who love God and are called according to a purpose. I will supply all your needs, or according to His riches in Christ Jesus. Where are we today? Before I pray, I want you to examine yourself right now. Where are you in Christ? It's important that we take this journey together on Friday nights. Your personal time is very, very important. It should be intimate between you and the Lord. He should be your best friend. He should be your lover. He should be everything to you. And if you are single, guess what? He's the best thing you got right now. Where are you as we walk into these first few weeks of this year? Are you willing to make a commitment? Are you willing to make a vow to Him? A sacrifice of praise for what He's done, the benefits that He has given you already. Just because we're alive is enough. I found this on my computer. I'm going to end here. I don't even remember putting this together. But it's about being a new creature in Christ. Old things have passed away. Where's it at, Jimmy?
2 Corinthians 5:17.
That's right. My favorite word in that verse is behold. He wants us to look everything that is behind us and now everything that is before us, in front of us. Have you ever looked at your life and felt that you always would be a victim of your circumstances? Maybe your parents neglected or abandoned you. Maybe there was physical or emotional trauma. Maybe there is a family history of alcohol and drug abuse. You may feel as though your course is fixed and you don't have a say-so, and that is just the way it goes. But that isn't true. God can and will intervene if you ask Him. I know from experience. At 18, I left home after graduating high school. This is me. And dropping out of college. I had a full scholarship to play sports. I could have played Europe. I was that good in soccer that I could have taken that to the fullest to play. But drugs took over. After a 20-year addiction in prison, I set out to break the mold. No more physical or emotional abuse, and no more addiction or alcoholism. I was left to myself. My mom and dad were on drugs and alcohol. I eventually would go into that direction. And then some. I could have permanently followed that course. That could have been the end of the story. But God took a hold of me in prison. When I asked Him for the help and strength, and the cycle was broken. And He could do that for anyone. I, my friends, am just an ordinary, very average person who took God at His word. And maybe you are trapped in some lifestyle, some pattern of sin, or some addiction. God can break that cycle. The question is whether you want Him to break it. Everyone wants the victory, but not everybody wants to do the work. Dale Strohberg. The Bible tells the story of a man who had been paralyzed for a long time, and Jesus said to him, do you want to be made well? We may wonder what kind of question that is to ask someone
who can't even move? It's a very good question, actually. Not everyone who is addicted wants to be delivered. Not everyone who is living a certain lifestyle wants to get out of that lifestyle. The question is, do you really want to change? And do you really want to be free? Because I know that Jesus can do that for you. Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord. Lord, as we just take a minute to examine ourselves, and we're going to have an opportunity to offer you in this room tonight during these last couple songs. I pray for open hearts and open minds as we get into this new year, for something to change dramatically in our lives, that we would make a commitment and a vow and have confidence knowing that you have met us tonight in our time of need. Yes, we are powerless over our dependencies and life had become unmanageable. But with you, all things are possible. All things are possible. We love you and we thank you. And we ask that in your name. Amen.
Amen.